morning and welcome to March 25th, 1941. I'm Henry Chapp, your host. And we have some interesting radio broadcasts tonight. One of them is particularly interesting. I'll tell you about it in just a little bit. If you enjoy the content on this channel, not only subscribe, but please donate to its upkeep. Because of the vintage old-time radio, films, and music that we feature, this channel does not qualify for YouTube monetization. Help motivate us to keep posting this wonderful content and seeking out more. We'd like to think that this channel is more interesting than any other nostalgia channel of a similar type. Help us keep going by donating. In the description section of this video, you will find a secure link to PayPal. Any little bit helps. Thank you for your support. If you love old-time radio, film, and music, don't forget to subscribe to this channel and click on the bell icon to get notifications as to when a new upload will premiere. If you are interested in World War II as much as I am, check out our other channel, the World War II Newspaper Channel. Expand the description section to this video and you will see a link that will take you there. Now I'd suggest listening to the latest upload to decide if it's your thing. Over there, you will hear the Chicago Tribune read to you for between 90 minutes to 2 hours. You will get a much more detailed look about what it was like to actually live through World War II than I can give you just by sharing radio broadcasts. You will not only hear detailed news of the big battles and historical events, you will hear trivial facts about the war. You will hear news from the United States home front from the early stages of U.S. mobilization and war protests to Pearl Harbor and the ramping up of the war machine to the final victories and reconversion. You will hear every facet of American life change forever. Well, tonight, well, we are, 9 months before Christmas. So 9 months from now, we will be celebrating Christmas. Yeah, I know it's really April, but we are back in 1941, right? We have that DeLorean's time machine set at, it's our old tube radio's time machine set at 1941, March 25th. Well, anyway, let me tell you what we are going to listen to tonight. We are going to start out at 9:15 in the morning over NBC Red with Vic and Sade and Muddled Shopping Money. So, I haven't heard these yet. I will be sitting back in my easy chair and listening to these with you. And then we have, Vic and Sade was broadcast out of Chicago. Actually, we have a lot of Chicago roots today on the radio. Then we have the First Nighter program, which was also broadcast out of Chicago. I believe still in 1941, it was broadcast out of Chicago. Later on, I think it moved to Hollywood. But in its early years, it was definitely a Chicago show. And the First Nighter's episode tonight was Love and Gazozza. And G-A-Z-O-Z-Z-A, Gazozza, whatever that means. Like I said, I haven't listened to these yet. And the First Nighter program, sponsored by Campana, aired at 7:30 in the evening over CBS. If you ever get out to the Chicago area, particularly the western suburbs, the old Campana factory still stands. It's a really cool Art Deco building. It's on Fabian Parkway, just south of Illinois Route 38, Roosevelt Road, which used to be alternate U.S. 30 or the Lincoln Highway. But it is a really cool building. It has a tower, a Art Deco tower that has a neon lights. I don't know if it's still lit up. I haven't been by there at night, but it says Campana in script in cursive. So all you youngsters might not be able to read it. I think they're teaching cursive again in school. But anyway, it is a really neat building. It's in West Chicago, Illinois, on Fabian Parkway, just south of Route 38, Roosevelt Road. You could probably Google it, Google Maps, too. But anyway, let me tell you what else we have coming up at 8:30 in the evening over NBC Red now on March 25th, 1941. Of course, it's Fibber, McGee, and Molly, a Tuesday night staple. And Fibber changes his name. So, he was on the air so many years at 8:30 in the evening, I think up until 1953, from 1939 to 1953, 14 years in the same time slot. Boy, that is saying a lot on how popular your program was. And then at 9 o'clock, you would have to change the dial. You're going to have to tune the dial a little bit to either CBS or NBC Blue, because both networks were carrying these. NBC Red or Mutual did not. and we're going to hear Lord Halifax speak for about an hour. He was the British ambassador to the United States, and this is probably a very historic speech. I haven't heard it yet. Like I said, I'm listening to these for the first time also tonight. So this is, I'm sure, a very historic speech because of the Lend-Lease Bill just being passed and the United States basically becoming officially an ally of the of Great Britain. Even though they're technically neutral, they were, in my mind, they're officially becoming an ally, and it's only a matter of time before a shooting war between the United States and Germany begins on in the North Atlantic. But I'm getting ahead of myself now, right? Without any further ado, let's turn on this old tube radio. That's our time machine. Let's give this stuff a listen.
And now get ready to smile again with radio's home folks, Crisco's Bacon Sage. In this time of year, it just seems like you have a million extra uses for money, doesn't it? Golly, with extra cash, you could fix up the house or even plan a swell vacation. And listen, you may win that extra money. Yes, in Crisco's big double cash contest. Why, there's 126 big prizes. A grand prize of $2,500, 25 prizes of $100, and 100 prizes of $10 each. And say, you can win even more than that. You can double any prize you win when you submit your entries on official entry blanks available only at your Crisco dealers. Or if your dealer doesn't have his blanks, just write your entries on plain pieces of paper and have your dealer sign his name and address to them. Either way, you will double the amount of any prize you win. It'll double that first prize of $2,500 to $5,000. Now to enter, write the fifth line to a jingle that's on those official blanks. Here's how the first four lines go. For cakes, pies, and frying each day, most any wise housewife will say, for cakes, pies, and frying each day, most any wise housewife will say, use Crisco, it's sure, so creamy and pure. Use Crisco, it's sure, so creamy and pure. Da-da-da, da-da-da-da, dum-day. Now that's where you write a last line. Maybe something like, and your meals get a hearty okay. And remember, your last line must end in a word that rhymes with day. You see? Isn't that easy? Oh, and it's fun, too. Why, you'll get ideas just from using that wonderful new Crisco. Try a Crisco cake or a pie or do some frying with Crisco and see if you don't get new compliments on your cooking. They'll help you get ideas for last lines. And remember, send in all those ideas because each additional entry means another opportunity to win. Why, in last year's Crisco contest, you should have heard how happy the winners were. Mrs. C.J. Barringer of Denver, Colorado, for example, said,
I'm thrilled beyond words. My husband and I will use the money for a grand vacation we couldn't otherwise afford. I urge everyone to enter and keep trying.
And that's mighty good advice. So here's what you do. With each last line you write for Crisco's jingle, mail your name and address and a Crisco label, any size or facsimile. Address Vic and Sade, Cincinnati, Ohio. That's Vic and Sade, Cincinnati, Ohio. This contest is open to residents of the United States and Canada. Entries will be judged solely on originality, suitability, and aptness. Remember, your Crisco dealer has official entry blanks with complete rules and the Crisco jingle printed on them. If your entries are on official blanks or if they're on plain pieces of paper with your dealer's signature and address, you'll double the amount of any prize you win. So today, see your dealer for official blanks. Win and double your winnings in Crisco's Double Cash Contest. Well, sir, our scene is a peaceful one as we enter the small house halfway up the next block now. Mr. and Mrs. Victor Gook and their son, Rush Gook, are spending a quiet evening at home. We find Vic established at the library table playing solitaire, Sade darning gentlemen's socks on the davenport, and Rush reading a storybook in the easy chair. And now, a considerable silence is broken.
Oh, darn it.
What's the trouble, Dr. Speech?
I just thought of something.
Don't tell me you left your lighted cigar on the highly polished surface of my dresser.
I was positive I had money matters between Ruthie and me all straightened out. Some stuff popped in my head just now that throws my calculations all out of kilter. Willie.
Uh-huh.
You're not busy. Skip out in the dining room and get me my pocketbook out of the top drawer of the buffet.
Okay. Well, George, this is an interesting story I'm reading.
Oh, it is.
Third Lieutenant Clinton Stanley among the counterfeit and left-handed natives of the Orange Sea, or how pluck and honesty won love, fame, and fortune. What I'm reading now, it tells about how Third Lieutenant Stanley faced death by drowning and escaped through a secret tunnel.
Come along, that's my pocketbook, Sonny. Darn it.
You said that.
No, but it makes a person tired. This trip, I was bound and determined I'd keep track of my money. Kept a strict record in my head of exactly what I started out with, exactly what I spent, and exactly what I ended up with. But sitting here just now, a couple items popped in my noodle, and I'm confused as a horse.
I expect you're talking about a shopping expedition with Ruthie.
Yeah, you know how we always do.
Get confused.
Lend each other cash during the course of the afternoon. Make purchases for each other. Buy articles for each other with the understanding the money is to be paid back later. And all this and that till we finally wind up without any notion of where we stand. But today I made a special effort to keep track. I kept tab on every single... Thanks, Willie.
Gov, want me to read you some exciting junk from my book?
I want to talk to Gov a minute. You got a pencil there handy?
You're darn right. I told her what was what that time. Hey, doggone it.
Well, take your pencil and a piece of paper and let's itemize this business step by step.
You know, of course, you interrupted my game of solitaire.
According to my figures, when I got home this afternoon, Ruthie and I come out exactly even. I owed her nothing. She owed me nothing. But there's a monkey wrench in the machinery someplace. Let's track down the difficulty.
Didn't we go through all this same sort of thing before and end up more in the dark than when we started?
Yeah, but today I kept tabs. Should be very...
You bought a nice shirt and Ruthie paid for it. You and Ruthie each bought... You lent Ruthie a dime and Ruthie paid back a nickel of it. Ruthie got waved in the weighing machine, the stranger found a penny.
It is generally that mixed up. Kept tabs. All right, $4.67.
Okay.
$4.67 represents the amount of money I had in my pocketbook when I locked the house this afternoon and headed for downtown.
$4.67.
I have in my pocketbook now $1.14.
$1.14.
I'll count it again to make sure.
Gov, what does the word grandiloquent mean?
Horse.
You don't know, huh?
It means horse. Grandiloquent is derived from the Greek root grandma and the Portuguese idiom yobo fickle seep. Or, in English, I am ill in my tent. Combine the two...
All right, $1.14.
$1.14.
Subtract that from $4.67. The result will be exactly what I spent while I was with Ruthie. Now we'll know where we stand.
Well, then, what does grandiloquent mean?
I'm busy, Willie.
The whole sense of the sentence I'm reading depends on this one word.
That's nice. You got that all subtracted accurate?
Got it all subtracted accurate.
What's the remainder?
$3.53.
Fine.
Yes, sir.
$3.53 represents the exact sum I spent while I was with Ruthie. Now, write down penny.
Penny.
Each of us bought a stick of gum in at the drugstore on the way downtown. We were on Market Street there, and we...
What's the matter?
Hey.
Huh?
Transaction took place in that darn drugstore I never kept a record of in my noodle. Ruthie bumped into Fred's boss's wife and paid her back a quarter she owed her, but only had a nickel and a dime in change, and I furnished the extra 10 cents.
Very well. So far, Ruthie's in debt to you.
Wait. That's all right. That's perfectly all right. She handed me back my 10 cents there in Kleeberger's. Or did she?
I really wouldn't be in a position to throw any considerable light on the subject, not having been present.
She handed me 10 cents, all right, but... Did that 10 cents represent the 10 cents she owed me from the drugstore transaction? Or the 10 cents she borrowed in at Yamilton's when we... No, because we were in Kleeberger's before we were in Yamilton's. Let me think a minute.
Go ahead.
Darn it.
Yeah.
Let me think a minute.
Hey. Third Lieutenant Stanley is bound and gagged. Can't move his legs. Can't move his arms. All he can do is flex his muscles. What do you think he does?
Buys a ticket for Dubuque, Iowa.
He gets Lady Margaret to put a bullet on his arm. Then he flexes his arm muscle real quick, and that bullet shoots across the river and kills a counterfeit and left-handed native of the Orange Sea. And then, by George...
Pick, I got it all straight in my noodle. You wrote down penny.
Certainly did.
Write down dime.
Dime.
I spent a dime in at Ensign's for shoelaces. Ensign's was the second place we stopped at.
Mm-hmm.
Third place we stopped at was Kleeberger's. Ruthie bought garters for Fred. She paid for them out of her own pocketbook, and there wasn't any other transaction.
I seem to recollect you saying a moment ago Ruthie paid you 10 cents in the Kleeberger's.
Well, she did, but we don't have to bother with that. See, it all cancels out, correct? She borrowed the 10 cents in at the drugstore and paid me back in at Kleeberger's. It cancels out in apple pie order.
Mm.
Now, the Hamiltons.
Mm.
Here's where we're going to find the monkey wrench in the machinery.
Mm.
Write down dollar.
Dollar.
Cubs, did you ever hear of anybody so strong they could lift a gunny sack full of gold?
We're occupied here, Willie. Save that till later.
Oh.
Write down dollar.
I've already done so.
Dollar represents what I paid for my wash racks.
Mm-hmm.
Write down 3 cents and mark it money I owe Ruthie.
Mm-hmm.
Because I bought a package of hairpins. Oh, wait a minute. I better keep this in order. I bought thread before I bought hairpins. I bought a spool of white thread number 50, price 5 cents. Hey, Ruthie's got that thread.
Is she?
Sure she has. I made my purchase, and while the clerk was wrapping it up, I stepped over to say hello to Miss Wilton there in the underwear, and Ruthie stayed to get my thread and put it in her pocketbook and forgot to give it back.
Hmm.
Well, that don't need to change our figures, though. She will give it back.
Hmm.
All right, now.
Hmm.
I bought 15 cents worth of candy for Ruthie, and Ruthie bought a 25-cent box of fancy-headed pins for me.
Oh, Sandy, kiddo. Well, you girls go shopping. Why don't you keep your purchases separate? No wonder you get yourselves in a labyrinth of high finance.
Well, candy and pins is simple. I got a record of it tucked away in my noodle. Here's what happened. I run up to the fourth floor of Hamilton's to look at dress material. Ruthie stayed downstairs. While she was looking over the stuff at the different counters, she found these pretty boxes of fancy-headed pins on sale and bought some for herself and me, too. Well, a little later on... Oh, say, Miss Crider.
What about her?
She enters the picture at this point.
Hmm.
She bumped into Ruthie while I was on the fourth floor and asked her to contribute to some church business or other. Ruthie give her a quarter for the two of us. Makes me owe Ruthie 12.5 cents, see?
Oh, yeah.
Sure. Well, when I got back downstairs, Ruthie told me about the contribution, and I dug in my purse after what I owed her, but only had 9 cents in change. So what's 9 from 12.5? 3? 3.5. Well, 8.5. We can forget the half.
Let's do.
Now, where were we?
The slightest
idea. Oh, the candy. I bought Ruthie 15 cents worth of candy, and she paid me right off the bat. Paid me 16 cents.
Why'd she do that?
Let's see, why did she? She gave me an extra penny. What was that extra penny for?
Maybe to send some deserving boy to college.
I don't know. I don't know where I stand.
Mm.
Maybe Ruthie owes me money. Maybe I owe Ruthie money. I don't know.
Mm.
It's all a rotten muddle.
Mm.
Darn it.
Mm.
Brush.
Uh-huh.
Wipe off your face. Chocolate or something on your chin. Darn it!
Which concludes another brief interlude at the small house halfway up in the next block. And there we leave Crisco's Vic and Sade until the next time. Lady, you may win the grand cash prize of $2,500 in Crisco's big double cash contest. And there's 125 other cash prizes. So get your entries in today. See your Crisco dealer for official blanks with complete rules and instructions on how to double any prize you win. And don't forget to listen to Crisco's Vic and Sade tomorrow. This is Mel Allen speaking.
Stay tuned next for the First Nighter program.
Campana's Italian Bomb presents the First Nighter program, a copyrighted feature, coast to coast.
at a time on the Great White Way, and once again, ladies and gentlemen, you're invited to attend an opening night performance in the Little Theater off Times Square. There'll be plenty of traffic tonight, so let's get an early start to the theater. Here's my cab, won't you step in? All right, driver, up Broadway.
Good evening, Mr. First Rider. Curtain in 2 minutes.
Thank you. We'll go right in. All right. We have just a moment now before the play begins. I see that the title of this evening's dramatic offering is Love and Gazozza, an original comedy romance by Virginia Safford, co-starring Barbara Luddy and Les Tremaine. The story is pure fiction and does not refer to real people or to actual events. And now before first curtain, let's listen to Eric Segerquist and his famous orchestra. The house lights are out, and here's the play.
Scott, are we out of gas?
Now, Dad, don't get excited.
290 in the shade and no shade. You would rent a car and drag me around to see Mexico in the raw?
Oh, we can probably get gas at that house.
What house?
See that gate? A big rancho like that would have gasoline.
Look, Emily, we're supposed to be on our way to my oil wells down at the Quantapec. And for no good reason, we're miles and miles away in Cholula. There's something fishy about this. Where's that Mexican fellow live?
Why, in Mexico. What Mexican fellow?
Why did he leave New York in such a rush?
He didn't. He left very slowly.
What happened between you and him?
Why, Daddy, I hardly knew him. Just a mere acquaintance. Why? Yes, look, Daddy, down the road.
Huh? There's some Mexican on a horse. Emily, stop digging around under the seat.
I've got to find my compact.
Buenas tardes, amigos.
Buenas tardes, senor.
Emilita. Nita, Emilita.
Why, Esteban, imagine running into you down here. Esteban, here's Daddy.
Daddy? Oh, that is to say, Senor Caldwell. Oh, this is wonderful. To find little Emilita at the gate of my hacienda.
This big rancho doesn't belong to you.
Oh, but gee, see?
Why, imagine that, Daddy.
Imagine.
But how did you get here?
Why, we ran out of gas.
Gasolina? But I have mucho gasolina. Come to my house. I will shower you with gasolina.
Just in the tank, please.
Oh, never. Never have I been so excited. I leap from my horse.
Oh, isn't he wonderful, Daddy?
I untie my lasso, and springing before the car, I tie it to the cow catcher.
He's going to tow us, Dad.
Yes, yes, I'm following the action.
Now I leap onto my horse. Yes, that's here we are. We are ready, no?
Ready.
Bueno. And off we go. Come in. I bid you welcome to my house. Come in.
Oh, how lovely and cool.
Hey, nice old place you have here.
Gracias, senor. It's the casa.
How's that?
It is your house, senor.
Oh, no, I couldn't take it. Yes. I see what you mean. Thanks.
Coming to the patio. Pedro has cool drinks waiting for us.
Oh, look, a fountain. And the flowers. Esteban, it's heavenly.
Heavenly now that you are here, Emilita. Senor, what will you have?
Is that Gazozza?
You like Gazozza, senor?
He's had it everywhere we've been in Mexico.
Thanks. You know, a fizzy pop like this would be a sensation in the States. I'd like to know who makes it.
Oh, Emilita, so many times I've dreamed in my mind of you, sitting here by my fountain. When you sent me away from New York...
I didn't send you away.
What you gave me, what you say, the fence?
The gate. But I said we'd always be friends.
My heart breaks. I come home to my hacienda, but always I think of you. Always I say to myself...
Stephen, please, not out in public.
Don't mind me. I'm strolling around the garden.
Everything is yours, senor. Pick all the flowers. Oh, Emily.
Stephen.
My little coffee blossom.
I was... Your what?
Coffee blossom.
Oh, Stephen, we must never, never quarrel again.
What is nothing to quarrel about now, my sweet? You have come. Each day I think, mañana she will see her mistakes. Mañana she will come. So now, it is mañana.
You mean you've been expecting me?
I knew you would realize how much you love me.
You knew. You were waiting for me. You're the most conceited person I've ever met in my life.
Conceited? Because I knew you would come?
I didn't. Dad had to come to Tehuantepec to see his oil wells.
So? Then why are you in Cholula?
We're just passing through.
Oh, you funny little monkey. You come here because you knew this is where your Esteban lives.
That had nothing to do with it, and you're not my Esteban.
Oh, but I am. I make myself a present to you. Oh, Emily, it does not matter. You are here. We are happy. I will show you my friendly country.
Well, we must be going.
To see my country?
Back to our hotel.
You talk of hotels when I'm making love to you.
It's the El Grande. Dad, come on, we must go.
Emilita, wait. I have much more to say.
You've already said a great deal.
Are we leaving already?
No, you must stay.
Come, Dad, where's our car?
Oh, Esteban, about that gasoline.
No, it was not necessary, senor. There was plenty of gasoline in the tank. Emilita, wait, you must not go.
Hurry, Dad.
Emilita, why you act like this? You are angry, but why are you angry? Why?
I prefer not to discuss it.
Senor, you are her father. Ask her why she's angry.
Why are you angry, Emily?
I'm not angry. I never felt more pleasant. Get in, Dad. Goodbye, Esteban. Thanks for the gasoline.
And the Gazozza. Ah, great stuff.
It has been my pleasure, senor. Hey, Melita, why you do this crazy thing? You come, you are happy, you go, you are angry. Why? Why?
Goodbye, Esteban.
So long. Adios. So, this is a pretty arm, I. You little spoiled monkey. Okay, but maybe this time I show you. Oh, caramba, how can I love you so much?
And the curtain comes down on the first act of tonight's play in the little theater off Times Square.
Smokey, in the outer lobby, you're downstairs, please.
Attention, please. Tomorrow morning, how would you like to get a letter with $100 in it? Could you use $100? How about $1,000? How about $5,000? Listen, you may think things like that don't happen, but they are happening. Tomorrow or the next day, five people, whose names I'll give you later in this program, actually will get the thrill of getting a letter containing $100. And a few weeks from now, someone will get a check for $1,000, and someone else a check for $5,000. How come? Because Campana is giving away $10,000 in cash in order to get people everywhere acquainted with the fact that there are now two kinds of Italian bomb on the market. For a good many years, there's been just one kind of Italian bomb, the famous regular Italian bomb, one of the most popular hand lotions ever developed. But now, realizing that some skins are less dry and less sensitive to weather, wind, and hard water than other skins, and that millions of women want a hand lotion for mild weather in the spring, summer, and fall, as well as in the winter, Campana has prepared a second kind of Italian bomb called Special Improved Italian Bomb. Now, we're sincerely interested in finding out which of the two kinds you like the better. We're giving away $10,000 in cash to get your opinion. $500 every week, that is $100 to each of five people, plus a grand prize of $5,000 and a runner-up prize of $1,000. Listen later and I'll tell you more about it. The first time.
riders are hurrying down the aisles to their seats. The lights are dimmed, and here's the second act of Love and Gazozza.
Coffee, senor?
Gracias, Pedro. Pedro, listen.
Si, senor.
Pedro, if you love a beautiful senorita, very stubborn, and she does not know what you want, but you know she loves you, though she will not admit it, what would you do?
I think beating is always good, senor.
No, Pedro. Women and horses must never be beaten. It makes them rear up on their hind legs and show their teeth.
I think beating is good. More coffee, senor?
Gracias.
Senor, how you feel about kidnapping?
Kidnapping? No. She would be a terrible captive.
Si.
What do you mean, si? You mean no?
Si, senor. No.
I might set fire to El Grande Hotel and then dash in a saber from the roaring flames.
But, senor, you own the hotel.
Si. That is right. But Santa Maria, I must do something. She's my life. She's everything. I cannot lose her again.
Senor, Tigita.
No, Pedro, no. Do not play now. I have no mood for music.
But, senor, it melts the cold heart. They love the romance, these little senoritas. The song beneath the window.
Oh, that is it. I will woo her like that. Give me the guitar, Pedro. Bring my horse. I go to town. I got to be romantic.
Another glass of Gazozza, Emily. It's delicious.
No, thanks.
Want to go out in the plaza and watch the handsome dons make goo-goo eyes at the senoritas?
Heavens, no.
Well, if you feel like that, why do we hang around here? Why don't we go on to the Wantepec?
No, I don't want to go just yet. The climate here agrees with me.
I give up. Of course, I never thought you'd marry a foreigner, but still in all, Esteban's a fine chap. I can see how a girl would. In fact, if I loved him enough to come all this way to see him, I'd marry him.
You two would make a lovely couple, dear.
Boy, bring me another bottle of Gazozza.
I thought he'd be here by this time.
By George, I wish I could find out who makes that stuff.
He must have been crazy to have thought...
Gazozza, senor?
Well, if he doesn't care, I don't either. I'm going to bed, Daddy.
It's hot inside. Nice out here in this patio. Say, waiter, who makes this Gazozza?
Why, you wish to know, senor.
Great Scott, why do you all act so suspicious?
No, sorry, senor. We are stranger here.
Good night, Daddy. I'm going in.
Nobody will tell me. You think I was planning to steal the stuff. Where are you going, Emily?
Oh, you... hasn't even tried to see me. What are you doing out there?
I'm singing.
Well, go sing somewhere else.
How can you be so cold of heart when you are so beautiful? Your lips like red cherries, your cheeks like fragrant peach blossoms.
Stop that. Go away.
So gentle, so little and lovely, I cannot live without you.
This isn't going to get you anywhere.
Mañana I will learn your name. Mañana I will seek permission of your papa to pay my respects.
Don't be silly. You know my name. You know me.
But tonight I pour out my heart in song beneath your window. Since the moment I saw you, senorita, my heart beats only for you.
Esteban, do you feel all right?
Oh, now you spoil it. You will not pretend with me.
But what sort of talk was that?
Listen. In New York, I make love the Americano way. Now I make love within my own country. I pretend I have seen you with your duenna in the plaza. I come sing beneath the grill of your window. Cuando se le de Havana, valgame Dios. It is beautiful, romantic. But no. You have no imagination.
Well, you needn't get mad. How was I to know you were...
You're a spoiled little brat. You think you can twist me around your finger, but no. I am finished.
Esteban, you're not going to let me go away, but back home.
Would you have me beg for love? No. This is the end. forever.
Esteban!
Adios.
I'd feel a lot better if you'd come along to the want pack.
No, Dad, I'm going back to the States. As soon as your train leaves, I'm going back to the hotel and pack.
And for Pete's sake, change your clothes.
Oh, stop fussing about these shorts. At least they're cool.
You shouldn't wear shorts down here. These people don't understand the way they look at you.
Oh, get on, Daddy. Oh, wait, your carton of Gazozza.
Oh, yes, 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 thanks. I must have that. And nobody will tell me who makes it.
Daddy, your train's moving.
Goodbye, Emily. Be a good girl.
Goodbye, Dad.
Senorita. Huh? Move. 1 minute. I command you to stop. Halt.
What? Do you mean me?
You. Come with me, pronto.
But, wait a minute. Let go of my arm. Let go. Help, please.
Did you call me?
No, not you. You let go of me. I want a policeman.
Me? I am the police.
You? Well, what are you trying to do?
The respectful citizens of Cholula demand I arrest you for running around in the street in your underwear.
Underwear? You mean these shorts? Don't be silly. Oh, let go of me. You can't do this. My father will... I said let go.
Oh, yes. Aha! You keep me.
Yes, and I'll...
So now I arrest you again for resisting a policeman of the law.
And the curtain comes down on the second act of tonight's play in the little theater off Times Square.
Smoking downstairs or in the outer lobby, please.
All right, now, here's some more news about the $10,000 that Campana's giving in cash. By the way, if you have this week magazine, turn to page 21 and get the full story about this contest. But listen, it's about the easiest contest you ever heard of. You don't need any entry blank. Here's all you do. Take a piece of paper, using one side only, write 100 words or less to complete either of the following two sentences. Sentence one reads, I like the new specially improved Italian bomb because. Sentence two reads, I still prefer the famous regular Italian bomb because. You finish either of these sentences, giving us your honest opinion. Then sign your name and address. Attach the front panel only from any size carton of Italian bomb or facsimile, and mail your entry to Campana at the address on the carton. Do this tonight. There's a contest every week giving away five $100 bills until April 28th. Each week's contest closes on Monday night. You can enter as often as you want to each week, provided you follow the simple rules. No entry blank is necessary, but the rules for the contest are available if you want them, at drug department and 10-cent stores. Plan now to win one of these weekly prizes. And remember, the grand prize winner and the runner-up prize winner will get $5,000 and $1,000 respectively, will be selected from the weekly winners. Here's your chance to make your dreams come true. Is rolling as he's ready for the last act, and there goes the curtain.
But you can't keep me locked up. Who do you think you are?
Me? I am Lopez, the man who keeps you locked up.
I demand to see the chief of police.
No speak English.
You let me out of here.
Maybe mañana, maybe next month. Yes, Bobby.
Now, listen, Lopez, let's talk this over. You must know that in America, everyone wears shorts for sport.
Oh, I think America plenty local country, I think.
Oh, go away. No, wait. Bring me some dinner. I'm hungry.
Oh, very sorry. Calabozo do not feed you. Against the law.
I just start?
Maybe you have some friend to bring you food. No?
No.
Too bad.
But I'm hungry. Oh, all right. Give me a pencil and paper.
You eat them?
I want to write a letter.
against the law.
Oh, now, listen. You've a kind, intelligent face. Heaven forgive me. A fine, handsome man like you wouldn't refuse me that much. Just a little letter. Nice, senor.
It is still against the law. But what you say about me is true. So here, the paper and pencil.
Oh, gracias so much. Well, wait just a minute. Here, now send this at once, please.
Mañana, mañana.
Now, send it to Esteban de Morris at once. You hear?
Si. Oh, el señor Esteban de Morris? Why you not say so? Hey, but Pacho, Pacho, wake up. Take it to El Señor de Morris. Andale, andale.
Esteban. Oh, darling, I knew you'd come.
Oh, I find you in the calabozo, little Evelita. Imagine.
Did you bring me something to eat?
What, see? In this big basket, my coffee brochure.
Oh, wonderful. Oh, poke something through the bars, quick.
Not so fast. First, you respond me one little question. For positively the last time, will you marry me?
Oh, so you're taking advantage of a starving girl. Well, let me tell you this. My answer is permanently, definitely no.
Then it is settled. You do not eat.
Huh?
I think I will rest a minute here on the ground.
Oh, go away and let me alone.
For the moment, I have nothing important to do. And I'm a little hungry. Tamales, tortillas, cold chicken.
I hope you choke.
Excellent.
If you were a gentleman, you'd make them let me out.
You do nothing for me, I do nothing for you. Oh, wish I brought along a little pepper.
You think you have me at your mercy, but what's to stop me from saying I'll marry you just to get some food?
No, you would not do that. Though you are a little devil. You love me too much.
Love you? I don't even like you.
So? You come all the way to Cholula to see me.
Oh, you.
You can think of nothing to say, no?
If I said what I'm thinking, they'd arrest me again.
Oh, how sad it is that every time we meet, we quarrel. What was it we quarrel about in New York? I've forgotten.
Well, I remember very well. It was because, well, at least you could have come back.
When I knew you would come here?
I was leaving this morning when Lopez arrested me. Esteban, did you tell him to arrest me?
I wonder. Would I like another piece of chicken?
Esteban, answer me.
Shall it be a wing this time or a leg? I just said to my good friend Lopez that I think the Americano senorita need a little watching.
Oh, how can you be so mean to me?
If there is anything you wish to say to me now, Emilita, I am willing to listen.
Don't be like that and then stop eating, can't you? I'm sorry.
Oh, no. You are just hungry.
Oh, I know I acted like a half-wit in New York. I'm a brat.
Oh, listen, Emilita. You do love me.
Yes.
You cannot live without me.
No.
Say it then.
I love you, Esteban. I can't live without you.
Oh, my little darling. Put your face up to the bars.
You going to feed me?
Oh. First, I must kiss you. Oh, amante, Emilita. No, I will come around and untie the lock.
But how can you?
It's very simple. I have the keys. Hey, what's going on around here?
Who said that?
What? It is Daddy. Listen, I'm on the track of it. I know the man's name. Feller on the train told me.
Daddy, what are you doing here?
I doubled right back. They said at the hotel you were in jail. What in thunder are you doing in jail, Emily? Oh, it is all right now, senor. We will have no more trouble with her. Fine. Listen, Esteban. This Gazozza man lives here in Cholula. His name is De Morris, and he has this factory. What, senor? I am the Gazozza man. No. His name is De Morris. Esteban de Morris, at your service, senor. You are the Gazozza. Well, by George. Why didn't you tell me you were looking for me? Why? Great Scott, man, I've talked of nothing else. Oh, yes. Young man in love. I know. Listen, are you paying attention to me now? Si, I'm listening, senor. I want to buy the American rights.
Oh, senor, I will make you my partner.
Partner? Say, that's great. We'll go back...
Yes, pardon me for interrupting, but can't somebody give me some of that chicken?
1 minute, darling.
Back to the hotel and draw up the papers. But what about Emily? How'd she get into jail?
Wait, senor. First, I wish to ask you for your daughter's hand.
Don't wait to ask me for anything. Just go marry her before she changes her mind.
Oh, Daddy, you are right. We will marry pronto. Not the mañana, not the next week, but right now.
Oh, Estevan, and then we'll have a beautiful big wedding breakfast.
And the curtain falls on another play hit in the little theater on Times Square. All right, here are the names of the winners in Campana's $10,000 cash contest. Their checks are in the mail. Here they are, Miss Nona Blair, Knoxville, Tennessee. Mrs. Owen E. McGillicuddy, Toronto, Canada. Miss Harriet Ellis, White Plains, New York. Major W. J. O'Callaghan, Painesville, Ohio. Mrs. Lottie B. Shipley, South Bend, Washington. 5 weeks to go. Next contest closes next Monday night. Keep tuned to this station. Elma Davis will follow with highlights of the news. And now we move out of the theater and into the street.
Here's your cab, Mr. First Matter.
Thank you. Good night. The First Matter program is a copyrighted radio feature. This is the Columbia Broadcasting System.
Stay tuned next for Fibber, McGee, and Molly.
The Johnson Wax Program with Fibber, McGee, and Molly. The makers of Johnson's Wax and Johnson's Self-Polishing Glow Coat, presented by Don Quinn, with music by the King's Men and Billy Mills Orchestra. The show opens with What This Country Needs Is More Love. The month of showers will be here before you can say Jack Robinson. And because of the coming showers, I'd like to pass along to you a very important housekeeping hint that will save you work and worry. It's this. Protect your window sills with genuine Johnson's Wax. Then you won't have to worry if the rain splashes into your open window at night or if a sudden shower comes up before you can get home. The tough film of Johnson's Wax guards the finish. The rain wipes off easily and does no harm. And, of course, the wax makes cleaning windowsills easier all year long, besides turning a dirt spot into a beauty spot. Waxing windowsills is just one of the 100 extra labor-saving uses for Johnson's Wax that you will find listed right on the package. These are all in addition to the use of this famous wax polish for your floors, furniture, and woodwork. By all means, Johnson Wax your floors regularly for beauty, for economy, and for saving work. Nothing adds greater beauty to your entire home than floors that gleam under a rich, mellow Johnson Wax polish. Buy some tomorrow. Last week, the master of 79 Westful Vista offered his services to the nation with no takers. And he is still mortified and chagrined at the humiliation. And here in the living room, one burning and one applying the old salve, we find Fibber, McGee, and Molly.
Goodness sakes, don't take it so to heart, dearie.
Oh, it wasn't the army turning me down so much, Molly. It was everybody scoffing at me. Nobody even believed my intentions was sincerely.
Well, you've got such a reputation for embroidering the truth that whenever you start talking, they give you the needles.
Well, I like that. There ain't a more honest, upright, straightforward, down-at-the-mouth guy in the world than me. You know that.
Yes, I know it, but I seem to be unique.
But why? Why? What did I ever do to make people doubt me?
Well, you're always so imaginative, dearie. Your memory is too good. You remember things that never happened.
Why, Molly, I resent that. Just because I skid around a little and josh people, that don't mean that... I wonder if they'd believe me if I said come in.
Try it.
Come in. They did.
Hi, mister.
Oh, hello there, little girl.
Where's your uniform?
Huh? What uniform?
Well, I thought you enlisted in the Army.
Oh, no, I... They says I was too important a guy to waste at this particular time, sis. They're saving me for a real emergency.
Oh, my.
So I guess I ain't got any beef coming.
Any what?
Beef.
I'm hungry.
That rat, sis, you're always hungry.
I know it.
Well, you got to learn to control your appetite, sis. It gives you character. Do you realize that when I was a young man out west, I lived on roots and berries for a whole winter? It's a fact. And when springtime come, I'd even gain 12 pounds and was tougher than rawhide. Well, even now, I'm a great kid in a street fight and the right guy to have around in a jam.
In a what?
In a jam. I know, you're hungry. Okay, Mrs. McGee will give you a couple of cookies.
I don't want a couple of cookies, I betcha.
Why not?
Because I bet you they wouldn't be very good with salt on them.
Who says you gotta have salt on them?
My mama.
What?
She says to take everything you handed out with a grain of salt.
Oh. Oh, she did, eh?
Sure. She says you can pull more wild yarns than a puppy with a sweater.
Is that so?
Fibber well... is a fibber. Fibber is a fibber. Fibber is a fibber.
Oh, I'm full of wild yarn, am I? Why, that impudent little twerp. I got a good notion.
Now, here, take it easy, dearie. She's absolutely right. You are a fibber.
I'm never no such a thing.
Well, when did you live on roots and berries for a whole winter?
In 1911. I was broke, and two families I knew put me up for the winter.
What two families?
The Charlie Roots and the Joe Berries. See, I was telling the truth. And that settles it, Molly. I'm going to do something about it and do it quick.
About what?
That name of mine, Fibber.
Well, how on earth did your parents ever come to call you Fibber in the first place?
They didn't. I was named after my fourth cousin, Walpole J. Fimmer.
Fimmer?
Yeah, but the minister that christened me had a cold in his head.
Well, I agree with you, dearie, that Fibber isn't very dignified.
Of course it ain't, and I'm going to change it, too, legally.
Change it to what?
Well, I might as well have one with some class to it. Something befitting the president of the Chamber of Commerce.
Oh, my.
Like Chauncey. Or Cyril. Or Archibald.
Say, how about Pierpont?
Pierpont?
My grandfather's name was Pierpont Driscoll.
Yeah?
He was in the clothing business.
Well, what's that got to do with it?
Well, his advertisements always said, get a Driscoll suit with two piers of pond.
Oh, help me up. I'm all cut. That was awful, Molly. Besides that, that's too tricky. How about Willoughby McGee? Or maybe Marmaduke? Or Parmalee? Hey, there's a good one. Parmalee Upton McGee. How's that?
Oh, that's no good.
Why not?
Think of the initials. P.U. McGee.
Oh. Hey, how about Ronald McGee? That sounds kind of ritzy, don't it? I kind of like that. Ronald McGee.
Ronald McGee.
Ronald McGee.
Ronald.
Ronald McGee.
Ronald McGee.
Ronald McGee. That does it. From now on, Molly, I ain't Fibber McGee. I'm Ronald. You get that?
Okay, Ronnie. But are you really going to change it legally?
You bet I am. We're going downtown right now and see a lawyer. Where's my birth certificate?
It's in the hall closet.
Well, you put your hat on while I get it.
All right, Ronald, but
yes.
I don't know what we're going to do about the initials on your handkerchiefs and everything.
Oh, well, we'll worry about that later. Dad's at this door anyway. I wonder what... Hey, Molly.
Yes?
Did you lock the door to this hall closet?
What'd you say, Ronald?
I said, did you lock the door to this hall closet? Oops!
Sade?
Never mind. I want to see those lawyers before they go out to lunch.
Oh, heavenly days, McGee. What's all the rush?
Well, I want to get there.
I think this business of changing your name is too silly for words, anyway.
Yeah. You didn't think it was silly when I changed your name, did you?
Well, that was different. Say, how about all your clothes and belt buckles and things with your initials on them, FM? How can you use those when you're Ronald McGee?
Oh, that's a trifling matter. Shucks, initials don't... Oh, my gosh.
What's the matter?
How about the initials I had tattooed on my chest?
Where your chest is now, dearie, they'll never be seen. Now, look, McGee, why don't you give up this silly idea and go home? You don't want to change your name to Ronald. Not really.
I do, too. Who wants to be called Fibber? Shucks, every time I meet somebody and say, nice day, ain't it? They smile, hold out their hands, and look up at the clouds. They won't even take my word for good morning.
Well, my goodness, you can't expect... Uh-oh. Here comes Mrs. Uppington.
Oh, that's just dandy. All I need right now is a few haughty whinnies from that horse-faced old hoot nanny.
Hush, don't talk like that. Well. Mrs. Uppington is not horse-faced. Her eyes are too small. Oh, how do you do, Mrs. Uppington? So nice to see you.
Oh, how do you do, my dear?
I believe you know my husband, Ronald McGee.
Oh, yes, I... Who?
Me, Uppy. Ronald McGee.
Well, I... Ronald?
That's his new name, Abigail. He's changing it.
I'm on my way right now to have it done legal, Uppy. From now on, I'm Ronald McGee. You like it?
Oh, it's perfect, Mr. McGee. But tell me, what is the purpose in changing your name?
Well, he thinks because his name is Fibber, everybody expects him to fib.
Oh, that's utterly ridiculous, my dear.
Sure.
My husband's name was Robert, but he never robbed anyone.
Why? Of course not. A mere name means nothing.
Oh, I don't know. You know my cousin Gus?
Yes.
Ain't he disgusting?
Really serious about this, Mrs. McGee?
Yes, I think he is, Abigail. And there's no use trying to talk him out of it. When his mind is made up, he's as stubborn as a male.
Don't you mean mule?
The terms are synonymous.
Okay, don't mind me. But it's my name, and I got a right to do with it what I want to do with it. And I'm determined to be Ronald.
Come to think of it, Mr. McGee, I agree with you.
You do?
Yes, I think Ronald is extremely fitting for you. It's appropriate, distinctive, and descriptive. Yeah.
Why, Abigail, you...
As a matter of fact, I often tell people that the way Mr. McGee talks... He is continually reminding me of that movie actor Ronald...
Oh, you mean Ronald...
Yes, Ronald Duck.
Ronald Duck. You see what I mean, Molly? Nobody takes me serial. It'll be different when I'm established with a more dignified moniker.
Well, I don't know why. A can of corn with a pretty label is still a can of corn.
Oh, so now I'm a can of corn. Well, let me tell you, Mrs. Ronald McGee.
Well, hello there, folks. What are you looking so grim about, Fibber? Well?
He won't answer to Fibber anymore, Mr. Wilcox. His name is Ronald now.
What? Ronald? Since when?
Since I said so, that's since when.
Say, what is this anyway? Are you serious?
I'm afraid he is. He doesn't seem to realize that a rose by any other name would still wind up in a Spanish dancer's teeth.
Oh, so now I'm a Spanish dancer too. Well, kid me all you want. Have your fun. I can take it. I've been taking it all my life. And why? Because my name was Fibber, that's why.
And that's why you should keep it. You can't discount the value of an old, established name.
I'll cooperate. What you mean, Wilcox?
Well, I mean, suppose the Johnson Company changed the name of Glowcoat. Now, wouldn't that be ridiculous? Why, Johnson's self-polishing Glowcoat is known to millions as the finest no-rubbing, no-buffing polish for linoleum ever made, isn't it? Why, the very word Glowcoat means easy to use, labor-saving, and economy.
He's got a point there, McGee.
Well, tell him to go sit on it.
Okay. I know when I'm not wanted. So long, Molly. It's still Molly, isn't it?
Oh, yes.
Good. Well, good day, Ronald, old chap. Pip, pip, chitty-o, chin up and all that. Carry on. Ha, ha, ha. Ronald.
Listen to that comedian, will you? Why don't he just come in, sell his glow coat, and get out? Who does he think he is, Barrymore?
Why not? You think you're Coleman.
And granted, I do not. I'm just a guy that nobody ever takes serious. Every time the word goes around that McGee has an idea, everybody starts cheering from the Bronx. Come on, I got to see that lawyer.
What lawyers are you going to see, dearie?
Biggest firm in town. Beetlebaum, Firestone, Fogarty, and Fumble. Otherwise known as Fee-Fi-Fo-Fum. Here's their office right here.
Yes?
Hi, sis. I want to see one of the partners about an important case. Who's in?
Well, Mr. Fiedelbaum is in court. Mr. Firestone is out of town. Mr. Fogarty is on vacation. And Mr. Fumble is tied up at the moment.
Tied up?
Yes. The other partners always tie him up when they go out. Otherwise, he chases ambulances.
How long does it usually take him to squirm loose?
He did it in 39 minutes the last time. He's getting to be a regular whodunit.
You mean Houdini, dearie. But maybe we better go someplace else now.
Hey, Clara, I've done it in 27 minutes. Had a little trouble with a knot under my chin, but... Oh, hello, kid.
Well, hello there, old-timer.
Don't tell us you're Mr. Fumble, the lawyer.
Sure I am, daughter. Specializing in trespass, easements, public domain, and noro contendere.
What was that last?
Noro contendere, Johnny. That means if you got a clear case of malfeasance with no malice aforethought, the circumstantial evidence shows indications of flotsam or jetsam with implied breach of garnishee, you should have got his license number.
He knows a lot about law, McGee.
Look, old-timer, can I consult you a minute on a special case?
Why, sure, Johnny. Step right into my office. And Clara...
Yes, Mr. Fumble?
If there's a phone call for me, tell him I want skin-em-a-rink $6 across the board in the fifth. Come on in, kid. You sit in the chair, daughter. You'll have to lean against the water cooler, Johnny. Only got one chair. Never had two clients once before.
You'll probably never have one client twice either.
That's pretty good, Johnny. But that ain't the way I heard it. The way I heard it...
I object.
Objection sustained. What's being sued for, Johnny?
Oh, he's not being sued.
I want to change my name to Ronald. Fibber is too undignified. It's misleading. It's untrue, immaterial, and rear elephant. Will you handle the case for me?
Nope.
Why not? Aren't you a lawyer?
Yep. But you don't need a lawyer to change your name.
What?
Just go ahead and change it, Johnny. Law says you don't have to go to court for that. Hey, Clara!
Yes, counselor?
Tie me up again, will you? Say, I bet I can get loose in 19 minutes this time. So long, kids.
The King's Men sing The Wise Old Owl.
When we strolled through the moonlight, you said, I love you. But the wise old owl in the old oak tree said, woo-hoo. You said you'd love me all your whole life through. But the wise old owl in the hickory tree said, woo-hoo. So I never thought we'd say goodbye. That old bird must have known that now tonight he and I would be under the moon alone. Maybe I'll find a new love, that's what I should do. But the wise old owl in the maple tree said, woo-hoo. I heard the wise old bird say, but how was I to know that he was just a-fooing me and you? When we stole through the moonlight, you said, I love you. But the wise old owl in the apple tree said, woo, woo, hoot-a-doo-doo-doo. You said I was the someone you'd sing love songs to. But the wise old owl in the cottonwood tree said, quote, woo. So I never thought we'd say goodbye. The old bird must have known that now tonight he and I would be here all alone. Maybe I'll find a new love, that's what I should do. But the wise old owl in the sycamore tree said, woo woo, woo woo, who you gonna love when your love has gone away?
Well, I don't know why we had to rush down here to the courthouse, McGee.
Well?
The old-timer said you didn't need any court's permission to change your name.
Ah, what does that old fuddy-duddy know about law?
He studied it.
Well, I studied algebra, too, and I couldn't give you the square root of a geranium. And irregardless of what he says, I'm going to do this right. I'm going to get the court's approval and have it in the record.
Well, how long do we have to wait for this judicial nip-up?
Not long. I sent my petition in by the bailiff. He's going to call me when
Well, hello there, Mrs. McGee.
Oh, hello, Mr. Gildersleeve. Yeah,
hello, Fibber. Hello, Fibber!
You know, Molly, I sometimes think they ought to have separate courts for the better class of people. The way the public is permitted to holler and yell in our public buildings is a disgrace to the
community. Now, look here, McGee. You heard me speak to you.
Did you mean me, my good fellow?
Yes, I mean you, and I'm not a good fellow. Anyway, I'm not your good fellow. Why don't you answer somebody when they speak to you?
Would you answer if he called you Jasper?
Well, Jasper's not my name.
Well, Fibber ain't my name either, Jasper.
He's changing his name to Ronald, Mr. Gildersleeve.
What? He is?
Yeah.
Ronald. What's the idea, McGee?
Because Fibber ain't dignified, that's what's the idea. It ain't commensurate with my professional and social standing.
Your social standing, huh? You, the Jeter Lester of Whistle Vista.
Who's Jeter Lester?
Have you seen Tobacco Road?
Don't change the subject. Who's Jeter Lester?
Why, you illiterate little four-flusher. You wouldn't know if I told you.
I wouldn't stand for that, McGee. You're not so little.
Now, you look here, Gildersleeve. If I didn't have important business in that courtroom any minute now, I'd teach you a lesson.
Oh, you would.
Yes, I would.
You couldn't teach multiplication on a rabbit farm, you ignoramus. And don't you double up your puny little fist at me, either.
Now, listen, he'll double up his puny little fist at whomsoever he wants to.
I'll say I will. That bullfrog baritone of yours don't scare me, Gildersleeve.
You're a hard man, Ronald.
Now, look here, boys. If you want to fight...
Excuse me. Mr. McGee's case is being called.
Thanks, Bill. Right in.
Mr. McGee's case. Oh, my goodness. Are you in trouble, little chum? Why didn't you let me know? Who did you kill, McGee? And I'll bet he deserved it.
No, it's just about changing his name legally, Mr. Gildersleeve.
Oh, I see. Ronald. Well, good luck, Ronald.
Thanks, Gildersleeve. Come on, Ronald.
Mr. McGee in the courtroom? Mr. McGee?
Here I come, Judge. I'm McGee.
The court has a petition in your name for legal change of nomenclature. Are you the petitioner?
Yes, he is, Your Honor.
And who are you?
Molly McGee. Molly Driscoll, as was, and married to the defendant for nearly 20
years. I ain't a defendant, Molly. I haven't done anything.
Now, what was the purpose behind your desire to change your name, McGee?
Business reasons, Bud.
Bud?
McGee, when you say, when you speak to Bud, say, Your Honor.
Excuse me, Judge. Yes, I want to adopt the name of Ronald McGee for business and professional reasons.
Well, what is your business?
Oh, a little of everything, Your Honor.
I think my favorite occupation, my avocado, you might say.
Avocation?
Yes, my... I think what I do best is fish.
That's so? Mm-hmm. I'm quite an angler myself.
Really? What's your angle?
He means sea fishes too, Molly. You ever been up in the Succotash River country, Your Honor?
Oh, where's that?
Oh, southwest of the Puyallup Mountains and east of the San Verde foothills. Not many fellows know about that place. Be glad to take you up there sometime.
Oh, thank you very much. You really get them up there, do you?
Say, by the way, what's your first name, Judge?
Conrad.
Tell Connie about the time he caught the 45-pound
Oh, yeah. Well, sir, that was in the spring of 1911, Connie. I just come back to camp with a big buck antelope for dinner.
Out of season to shoot antelope, wasn't it?
Well, I didn't shoot it. I strangled it. Self-defense, you know. It attacked me first.
Yeah, with a knife this long.
No. Oh, no, Nolly. Not with a knife. That's ridiculous.
Well, go on, McGee, about this big fish.
What big fish? Oh, yes. Well, sir, everybody knew there was a big fish in that part of the Succotash River, but nobody'd ever seen it till I come along and caught it.
Well, what bait did you use?
2 aspirin tablets.
Aspirin tablets? My word, never heard of such a thing.
Oh, you didn't? Oh, they say they're fine for a headache, too. Well, sir, I dropped my line over the back of the motorboat.
Motorboat? How on earth did you ever get a motorboat up in those mountains?
He packed it in by dog sled, didn't you, dearie?
I didn't know there were any sled dogs in this part of the country.
Oh, I raised these myself. Kind of a sideline with me.
Personally, I always thought raising those dogs took too much time away from your counterfeiting, dearie.
What's this? Counterfeiting?
Yeah, I used to build counters and fit them into new stores, Jeff. I'm an expert cabinet maker.
Oh, I see. Quite an all-round fellow, aren't you?
Oh, indeed he is, Your Honor. He's around all the time.
What was I talking about? Oh, yeah. Well, sir, I seen I was running out of gas, so I adjusted my parachute and got ready to bail out.
Bail out of what? You were in a motorboat fishing.
Fishing for what? Oh, yeah. I just wanted to see if you was paying attention, Connie, old man. Well, sir, I never had such a battle with a fish in my life. The minute salmon smelled the roquefort cheese, I always used roquefort as bait for salmon.
Now, just a minute, my good man. I think this has gone far enough.
I haven't caught him yet.
I never heard such a string of fables in my life. Huh? You're insulting my intelligence.
Say, he never said a word about your intelligence.
Why, Judge, Conrad, you mean to sit there in your big black nightgown and accuse me of...
Be quiet. I've heard enough. Leave this courtroom.
But how about his petition, Your Honor?
What petition?
Why, to change my name. I want to change my first name to Ronald.
From what?
Fibber.
Petition denied. Now get out!
Ronald, Fibber and Molly will return in just a moment. In the meantime, I'd like to say a word about dogs. You know, Scotties and Cocker Spaniels and Terriers. They're so loyal and they look up at you with such kind, dependent eyes. They really are wonderful pals to have around, aren't they? Especially if you have children. And yet, when they come romping across your clean kitchen floor with wet, muddy feet, it takes a woman with a very good disposition not to get angry. I should say either a very good disposition or a kitchen floor that's protected with Johnson's self-polishing glow coat. After all, you can't put a fence around your kitchen. The groceries, meat, and milk have to be delivered. Why not solve that kitchen floor problem once and for all with Glow Coat, the modern floor polish that takes no rubbing or buffing, that shines as it dries, and protects your floor with a long-lasting, beautiful finish. You simply apply Glow Coat and let it dry. In 20 minutes, your floor is protected and beautiful, and the linoleum colors are as bright as new. Buy a can of Johnson's self-polishing Glow Coat right away.
Molly?
Yes?
Look, when I started to tell that judge about an innocent fishing trip, why did you have to throw in all that extra stuff? That's what ruined me. Now, I had to back you up.
Well, I was just demonstrating, dearie, that you're naturally much more of a Fibber than you are a Ronald.
Mm-hmm.
You don't really care, do you?
No, not really. But what burns me up, that judge deceived me.
How?
Well, I've been looking at the Atlas, and there ain't any Succotash River in the Puyallup Mountains.
He didn't say there was. You did.
Huh? Oh, that's right. Well, good night.
Good night, all.
This is Harlow Wilcox, speaking for the makers of Johnson's Wax and Johnson's Self-Polishing Glow Coat, inviting you to be with us again next Tuesday night. Good night.
Hello, folks. I'm your garage man. You know, times surely have changed. Well, I remember when it used to take half a day to wax polish your car. Real hard work, too. And now look how easy the job is with Johnson's Car New. And look at that row of shiny cars. Don't they look swell? Yes, sir, wax polishing is easy with Car New because Car New both cleans and wax polishes in one operation. Try Johnson's Car New yourself. It doesn't cost much.
This is the National Broadcasting Company.
Stay tuned for a special broadcast.
Invitation to Learning, regularly heard over many of these stations each Tuesday at this time, has been postponed until Friday, March 28th, from 10:30 to 11 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, in order to bring you a special broadcast of the Pilgrim Society Dinner with an address by Lord Halifax, British Ambassador to the United States.
From the Grand Ballroom of the Waldorf Astoria Hotel in New York City, Columbia brings you the first public utterance of the British Ambassador to the United States, Lord Halifax.
Mr. Chairman, and pilgrims of the United States, my first words must naturally be to thank you for the privilege of allowing me to be your guest tonight and for the generous way in which you have received me, and the chairman for the all too generous words in which he has introduced me to you. Lady Halifax and I have been deeply touched by the spontaneous kindliness of the welcome which awaited us, I was about to say, from the first moment that we touched American soil. But we can never forget that the welcome had begun before we ever landed with the President's truly wonderful gesture in coming to meet us. And that was an act of kindness which went straight to the hearts of my countrymen and which they will always gratefully remember. There had naturally, as you will believe, been an element of sadness for us in saying farewell to our home in England at such times as these. But if we felt a pang at leaving old friends there, you have gladdened us greatly by making us feel that we have the opportunity of making countless new friends here. I was very sorry that it should have been necessary to postpone the date of this gathering, and insofar as I was the unwilling author of much inconvenience, I would ask leave to express my own personal apologies. But that postponement has had at least one happy consequence. for it has enabled us this evening to enjoy the presence and presiding genius of Dr. Nicholas Murray Butler, than whom no one has done more by the words spoken and written to place before his fellow countrymen and the world the realities of these present times. My last engagement before leaving England was to meet the pilgrims at a farewell luncheon, which they were good enough to give to me on the eve of sailing. And it is, as you, sir, have reminded us, in accordance with tradition, that the first public speech of a new British ambassador in this country should be made before the kindly and distinguished audience of the pilgrims of the United States. I must confess that one of my earliest feelings on appointment as ambassador to the United States was a tremor of apprehension at the number of speeches which I might be expected to make. Nor was it possible for me, if I may make a confession to you, nor was it possible for me, except at a price that I should have been reluctant to ask you to pay, to find relief in the advice once given to me by Lord Balfour when I first entered the House of Commons 30 years ago. I told him that I felt rather like a new boy arriving at a strange school. "My dear fellow," he said, "there is never any need to be nervous in the House of Commons. All you have to do is to speak as often as you can and as long as you can, and you will rapidly lose any sense of mercy for your audience, as every bore always does." Well, the reason of my coming to you is, of course, well known. I told your fellow pilgrims in London some of the reasons which had moved me to submit to the King the name of Philip Lothian to be His Majesty's ambassador at Washington. He came to you indeed as no stranger, but as one who already knew and loved your country and who had many good friends among you, and who was in a special degree equipped to undertake the task. And I little thought at that time that it would fall to me to succeed him after the tragically short period of 15 months. But the value of men's work and men's lives is not to be measured in length of days, and I do not hesitate to say that the year which Lothian spent here was the most formative and the most important of his life. He had long prepared unconsciously for it, and when the opportunity came, he gave himself without stint to that which is the purpose of your society, the cause of better understanding between our peoples. And the fruits of his labor stand today for all the world to see. And he would not, I think, have wished any better monument. Gentlemen, I suppose that seldom before in the world's history can so much have depended on that understanding. And for that reason, the Prime Minister of Great Britain rightly described this post that I have the honor to hold as the most important at this time which any British subject can occupy outside the United Kingdom. Nor is the reason far to seek why recent months have seen a steady drawing together of the thought of our two countries. You and we have felt from the outset that the instinctive reaction of our two peoples to the challenge offered by the new philosophy of totalitarian dictatorship must be identical. And as the struggle has grown more intense, reason and conscience have combined to make us both realize even more clearly the dark menace to things that are equally precious to your country and to mine. And this common purpose has been sealed anew by the recent passage into law of the Lease-Lend Act. It is difficult to exaggerate what this means. Across the seas, in the front line, which is Britain, as in the hearts of those submerged for a time under the German wave, there will be felt new confidence. In the camp of the enemy, new doubts, as all alike remember the history of the last war and see the time surely approaching when the weight of this nation must tip the scales. And if the British Commonwealth have felt able, as we have, to count upon the increasing support of your moral and industrial partnership in this business, we hope that you too have seen the bearing of the British people to be such as you would have expected from your own people if they were similarly placed.
You are listening to an address by the British Ambassador to the United States, Lord Halifax.
Personality often lingers where at some forgotten time has been stamped the mark of deep human feeling. So day by day, the number of those places grows which will long speak to any Englishman of the courage and self-sacrifice that they have seen. We are wont to say, as you, Mr. Chairman, have just reminded us, that we are fighting for freedom and for democracy. For freedom as the quality of life that we desire, for democracy as a system of government which is at once its best expression and the surest guarantee for its protection. What do we mean when we use these large words? I can only tell you what I mean and what I know my fellow countrymen mean, even if they do not always translate it into precise language, and I do not think you will take any different view. There seem to us to be certain principles that that are essential to life as we wish to live it and see it lived. And those principles are now in dire peril. And we believe, therefore, that we are truly fighting for our lives. Since life to us is worthless, if the principles on which it is built are to be destroyed. And we do well, I think, to remind ourselves what these principles are. For they, like the iceberg, of which the greater part is out of sight, lie deep down, below the surface of man's outward being. And I would state thus what in varying forms is in many minds today. First, the religious principle of the absolute value of every human soul. And second, the moral principle of respect for personality and for conscience. And third, the social principle of individual liberty, finding its expression in two ways: in the sphere of politics, through equal opportunity, justice, and the rule of law, and economically, through the direction of national effort to the creation of conditions that may bring some real security into the daily life of our humblest citizen. And finally, the domestic principle of the sanctity and solidarity of the family, which is a natural development of the individual. And I venture to say that unless we build our life on these foundations, a religious, a moral, a social, and domestic, we have no hope of finding the way of happiness. It is only by slow process that man has learnt to apprehend these principles. They have come to him by Christianity and by other great religions. They have drawn vitality from the best of human thought all through the centuries. For us, they are expressed and protected by democracy, and that is why we value it. There are, of course, other nations who have different systems of government, but who are not less concerned than ourselves to secure the way of life which these principles reflect. And this is because it is on their maintenance that rights fundamental to human life and progress plainly rest. And from those principles, I believe, derive rights that, following your Declaration of Independence more than 150 years ago, and following also that historic speech of your president 10 days ago, I would assert for all men today the right to think, speak, and act freely within the law, and to have free access to the thoughts of others. The right of free association, both national and international, with their fellow men. The right to live without fear of aggression, injustice, or want. The right to believe and worship as conscience may dictate. And it is the vindication of those rights, that men today passionately desire. It has sometimes been suggested that the tradition of freedom in Western Europe is a recent growth. But the heroic struggle for popular government, continuously waged since the early Middle Ages in my own country, as in almost every part of Europe, proves conclusively how old and how widely rooted is the idea of freedom. Your country, America, is the creation of men who so valued freedom that they called a new world into being in order to maintain it. The British Commonwealth has grown in an atmosphere of freedom and has developed the principle and the practice of self-government. And we see the fruits of it in the march of free men from the four corners of the earth, men whose loyalty to the common crown, for them the symbol of liberty, has brought them to fight by sea and land and air at our side today. Now, there is no inch of common ground between those who accept and reject those principles or assert or deny those rights. The Nazi system is bondage, a bodily and spiritual, a political and economic. According to Nazi philosophy, the state both may and must claim the whole allegiance of man's body and soul. A truth, a conscience, mercy, honor, justice, love, where these clash with what is held to be the overriding interest of the state, they are regarded by Hitler as offenses. And as Hitler plans the world under his so-called new order, it would be divided into Germans, the master race, and other nations, second-class peoples, with rights and interests subordinated to those of the ruling caste. For Europe, such a system involves the shackling of industry and commerce, ruthless compulsion in place of free contract, and the permanent enslavement of all peoples. But, Mr. President, German ambitions do not stop at Europe. Already Hitler is scheming to overrun great tracts of Africa and of Asia. And across what have now become the Straits of Dakar, the invader of Africa, if he could once establish undisputed mastery of Europe, could swiftly pounce upon your Latin neighbors to the south. The American continent, a standing challenge to German domination, could be attacked before it had had time to arm in self-defense. And in any case, the doors of trade in Europe, Asia, and Africa would be closed to it, except on terms laid down by Germany. Would Hitler, in fact, attempt this last and greatest act of highway robbery? We cannot tell. Some will advance arguments against the likelihood of his so acting. He might indeed achieve much the same result without actual armed attack. But others may surely feel with greater force that where national security is involved, it is not enough to rest upon a disputed balance of probability. We in Great Britain had to answer much the same question for ourselves. I have no doubt that at the price of allowing Hitler to work his will in Europe, we could at any time in the last few years have temporarily reached an understanding between the British Commonwealth and the German Reich. But quite apart from the morality of any such arrangement, what would have been the assurance of its durability? Lust for power is like a cancer that must constantly extend its ravages. And with all the experience we had had, I have no doubt whatever in my own mind that any such arrangement would only have served to establish Hitler in a position of still greater strength to attack the British Commonwealth at his own moment. And certainly, no pact or treaty ever made with Hitler, who has broken nearly every international promise he has ever made, would either have been or be worth any more than all the others made in all good faith by his European victims. I am therefore not surprised that the overwhelming sense of your people should be to reject the new dispensation that, with all its inevitable consequences, Hitler seeks to impose upon the world. I have seen it suggested that the evil things against which we strive are less black than they appear. We are but witnessing today, so runs the argument, one of those titanic outbursts of energy that since the dawn of history have blazed the path of progress. As then, so now. Time will purge the dross until from the ashes new strength and new beauty spring. Gentlemen, such judgment takes no account of the stark realities with which we are faced. This struggle, as you, sir, have said, is a mortal clash of two philosophies. And we only delude ourselves if we suppose that the civilization that we share with you could survive a Nazi victory. And it is not only with physical invasion that you and I are concerned, but with a spiritual invasion, which, if permitted, would work greater havoc than all the tons of high explosive that it is in the power of the German Air Force to unload.
Lord Halifax, British Ambassador to the United States, is speaking on the topic Great Britain and the Post-War World.
That in the individual sphere makes it impossible for any man to keep his soul alive if he consciously permits his life to reflect two contradictory ideals. That, then, is why we are at war. To save our freedom and the world's freedom from being murdered as it has been successively murdered in Czechoslovakia, Poland, Norway, Denmark, Holland, Belgium, Luxembourg, and France. We will never accept Hitler's new order, which is in truth a reversion to the old order before men were civilized, and which would paralyze them again under chains of brutal and selfish and material force. And we reject it because, as the president finally said on the 6th of January, we prefer the conception of a moral order based on the noble human qualities that Hitler would destroy, by which nations and men can grow to full stature through service freely given to the common good. And so, the principal war aim of my people and of all those who are fighting with us is to win this life and death struggle for the cause of human freedom. But, Mr. President, even the achievement of victory would be Dead Sea fruit unless we can also achieve that which must be the greatest peace aim of securing the world, as far as it is within human power to do so, against a repetition of this tragedy. Mr. Churchill, in a moving passage at the end of one of the volumes, I forget which, one of the volumes of The World Crisis, said, "Merciful oblivion draws its veils, the crippled limp away, the mourners fall back into the sad twilight of memory. New youth is here to claim its rights, and the perennial stream flows forward, even in the battle zone, as if the tale were all a dream. Is this the end? Is it to be merely a chapter in a cruel and senseless story? Will our children bleed and gasp again in devastated lands?" These questions demand an answer today, even more insistently than they did when they were first asked 20 years ago, for one large attempt at general resettlement has crashed in ruins and left the pieces to be put together under conditions of infinitely greater difficulty. This is not the time to appraise the several elements which have conspired to defraud the highest hopes of men. It may be argued that the authors of the Treaty of Versailles were overburdened with political problems to the detriment of economic. But if so, they are not the only people who have made mistakes. We must all acknowledge part of the responsibility for failure, and if we may, learn wisdom from it. And when this great battle has been won, the nations which have preserved or regained their freedom will have a sovereign opportunity to show what freedom means and what it can do for the welfare of mankind. It is not possible, of course, now to draw detailed plans for the future structure of the community of nations. These must naturally await discussion in free council by those concerned. But we are, I think, already in a position to see the basis on which agreement must be founded. And nations, like individuals, can only exist in freedom and security if they are prepared to cooperate for mutual economic welfare and, if need be, for mutual defense. In the economic sphere, indeed, everything depends upon such cooperation. But no party to such an association as we picture will be ambitious to dominate its partners. Every nation, great or small, will have its place and make its own contribution. And moreover, past experience teaches us that a stable international order must admit of ordered change in the relations between states. Just as the liberty of the individual must have regard to the needs of the community, so must every nation in future accept its obligations to the general family of nations. All rights, whether personal or national, are always morally linked with duties. The spirit that impels a good citizen to give willing service in one form or other to the state will imply for the nation a readiness in both political and economic spheres to consider the welfare of its neighbors. We, for our part, are prepared to join hands with any state which genuinely seeks the peace and prosperity of the world by loyally observing engagements and by ensuring individual liberty within its borders. It will be of no value to force unwanted associations upon unwilling nations. We must rather try to create conditions, political and economic, in which there may grow among the peoples themselves a real vital sense of their community of interest. Mr. President, in the British Commonwealth of Nations, our experience has taught us that nations, differing greatly in numbers and wealth, in race and social structure, can yet freely associate together. What has been possible for them is not impossible for others. And the British Commonwealth, which by the quality of its resolution is the bastion of world defense today, may well, by its geographical dispersion, become the bridge of greater world unity tomorrow. In many respects, the world must be treated in future as a single whole. Since the last war, we have seen an increasing difficulty in securing the distribution of the world's abundance, both within and across the national frontiers, with adverse effects upon the workers' standard of living everywhere. We had hoped to see the vision of plenty banishing the specter of scarcity. But what, in fact, we have seen has been the failure of men to exchange with their fellow men the abundant products of both farm and factory. When, therefore, victory has been won, it must be our aim to promote the common interest in the greatest possible interchange of goods and of services. For problems involving common needs can only be solved by common action. We see the urgent need for economic cooperation, and we are ready to take part in plans to promote it on a worldwide scale. Our aim will be prosperity justly shared. And even now, we are making plans to remedy the impoverishment which must follow in the train of war. We are arranging to establish stocks of food and raw materials which can be released as soon as we can be sure that they will be used for this work of healing and not for our destruction. Gentlemen, this business of rebuilding after the war will be, of course, a task far beyond the strength of any single nation. Great Britain is resolved to do her utmost, but it is quite clear that if the world is to be brought back to health after so devastating a sickness, it will only be by the united action of all men and all nations of goodwill. It will not be easy, for we may be very sure that the upheaval now convulsing the nations will not leave things as they were. A new world is being born as we speak of bitter suffering, and the problems of peace will be in many ways more difficult than the problems of war. New needs will demand new remedies, and there will be room alike for all the courage and imagination of youth and all the clear thinking of experience that can be rallied to the task. In this war, my country seeks no selfish end. Its immediate cause, as in 1914, was the German breach of a treaty on the one hand and the fulfillment of a treaty by Great Britain on the other. The ultimate cause was Germany's lust for world power and her concentration of her resources for the single purpose of military conquest. And therefore, it must be our aim in the present war to convince the people of Germany, that these traditional ambitions and methods do not pay. One of the greatest tragedies of this time is that for years, German youth has been impelled by its rulers to the pursuit of spurious ideals and to the worship of false gods. And the gulf that has thus been dug between them and the younger generation here and in my country will take time to bridge. And therefore, after the war is over, and until we can be satisfied of Germany's cooperation, I can hardly doubt that nations resolved to preserve both peace and freedom must needs retain sufficient armed strength to make their will effective. And I dare to hope that in this, as in other matters, our two peoples will appreciate the immense responsibility that will jointly rest upon them. And that, in the words of Pascal, we may combine justice and power, making what is just strong and what is strong just. So, I think, may the spirit of our cooperation deserve and win the support of all other peoples like-minded with ourselves to strengthen the foundations of world society. And thus only will it be possible to ensure that neither Germany nor any other nation shall revert or has any reason to revert to those policies which have plunged Europe into five wars within the last 80 years. Mr. President, I have not spoken to you tonight about the fortunes of war, as they may be in whatever field during the coming months, and of what the future may hold for us of good or of ill, nor of the flagging purpose of the Italian people following the rout of Mussolini's legions in Africa and in Albania, where a small country, as you said, has once again written history in letters of flaming gold for all the world to read.
You are listening to the British Ambassador of the United States, Lord Halifax.
Nor have I spoken of that particular threat to the passage across the ocean highways on which our war effort and your great reinforcement of it rests. Certainly, we do not minimize its gravity or shut our eyes to the fact that it is here that Hitler will put forth his greatest effort. But our experience shows that while in the coming months these attacks may and will cause us grave losses, our defensive measures are sound, provided they can be developed with adequate strength and with adequate speed. In the next few critical months, it will, as I see it, be a race between the mounting total of our shipping losses and the increase in the defensive weapons that will reduce them below the danger level. And I have no doubt that with the help that you will be able to give of our ability to win this race. I have rather preferred to speak to you tonight of other matters that were in my mind, the more so since many of you will have heard the Prime Minister himself some weeks ago make a speech which once more stamped him, I think, as a born leader of men determined to be free. There is, however, one more thing, if I may, that I would like to say. The question which I find perhaps most frequently on the lips of my American friends is, when will Hitler invade Britain? The question is vital, for Hitler can stroll across the continents where he will, but unless he can reduce that small island in the North Sea, which is the cradle of the British race, the end he seeks eludes him. And he knows better perhaps than we do that provided we can hold, as we surely shall, his dreams. He knows his dreams are doomed. When then will he put it to the test? For many months, people in more countries than yours or mine have been asking the same question. And I dare say Hitler has been asking it of himself. And therefore, you will hardly expect me to answer it. But if you ask me, can such invasion succeed? Or in other words, will all the help that we are planning to send to Britain arrive too late? Then both my head and my heart join to tell you, with all the conviction born of my knowledge of how the British people feel and of being a member of the War Cabinet since its formation, that the answer is a confident and unhesitating no. And I base that belief not only upon all the preparations for defense which have been forging ahead night and day since Dunkirk, and not only upon the tireless devotion with which the Navy and the Army and the Air Force, yes, and men and women throughout the length and breadth of the country have been fitting themselves to do their duty in the ordeal which they know they may have to face at any day and at any hour, nor on the generous help that you have given and are giving, and that as Hitler's desperate bid to prevent it is brought under control, will reach our shores in steadily increasing volume. All these things play a great part, but there is something more which it is not wholly easy to reduce to words. It may be perhaps expressed by what an English woman wrote to an American friend after the first great onslaught from the air. There is, she said, there is a complete absence of hysteria everywhere and only a lovely growth of friendly behavior. A woman in a country village writes, "We are expecting the invasion soon now, and we are told that if they get as far as this, we have to stay put. It won't be easy, but it's going to be done. We're not going to hamper our men by cluttering up the roads." And a London woman, a week or two ago, we've been warned to leave our house on account of a time bomb lying nearby. They declared, if you will pardon her language, because it's hers and not mine, "The landlord has tried to turn me out. The bailiffs have tried to get me out. I'm damned if Hitler's going to do it now." Or perhaps one gets a glimpse of it in the words of an airman whose leg had been amputated and who, in a brief interval of returning consciousness, said, "It takes a lot to kill a man from Stoke-on-Trent." Well, I could multiply such stories, and you have no doubt heard others. At some we laugh, but our laughter is not always far from tears. But they may explain why I feel able tonight to tell you with a conviction that is quite unshakable that the British people will not be unworthy of the cause by which they stand.
You have been listening to Lord Halifax, the new British ambassador to the United States, make his first American public address before the traditional Pilgrim Society dinner being held here in the Grand Ballroom of the Waldorf Astoria Hotel in New York City. This is the Columbia Broadcasting System.
That was very interesting and very dramatic in a way, wasn't it? Boy, oh boy, you can tell that things are really going to start heating up pretty soon as far as the war goes. And you gotta wonder when things are going to come to a head, huh? Well, I'll tell you what we're going to listen to tomorrow night, March 26th, 1941, in just a little bit. If you enjoy the content on this channel, not only subscribe, but please donate to its upkeep. Because of the vintage old-time radio, films, and music that we feature, this channel does not qualify for YouTube monetization. Help motivate us to keep posting this wonderful content and seeking out more. We'd like to think that this channel is more interesting than any other nostalgia channel of a similar type. Help us keep going by donating. In the description section of this video, you will find a secure link to PayPal. Any little bit helps. Thank you for your support. If you love old-time radio, film, and music, don't forget to subscribe to this channel and click on the bell icon to get notifications as to when a new upload will premiere. If you are interested in World War II as much as I am, check out our other channel, the World War II Newspaper Channel. Expand the description section to this video and you will see a link that will take you there. Now, I'd suggest listening to the latest upload to decide if it's your thing. Over there, you will hear the Chicago Tribune read to you for between 90 minutes to 2 hours. You will get a much more detailed look about what it was like to actually live through World War II than I can give you just by sharing radio broadcasts. You will not only hear detailed news of the big battles and historical events, you will hear trivial facts about the war. You will hear news from the United States home front from the early stages of U.S. mobilization and war protests to Pearl Harbor and the ramping up of the war machine to the final victories and reconversion. You will hear every facet of American life change forever. I'm Henry Chopp, your host, and tomorrow night we are going to take a look at Wednesday, March 26, 1941, and we have our typical Wednesday stuff, nothing really unusual going on. Tomorrow night we have The Lone Ranger, The Adventures of Superman, Mandrake the Magician, The Cavalcade of America, and their production of Down to the Sea. We have both the East Coast and West Coast versions, once again, of the Texaco Star Theater with Fred Allen. And sandwiched in between those, we have the Eddie Cantor program and a great show for tax time. The IRS tries to give Eddie an audit. So hopefully none of you guys out there can relate to that. But with it being income tax season, even now, it's a month later now, but back then it was March 18th, so it would have been a week before this broadcast. It's a topical program for sure, so definitely come back again tomorrow. And until then, I'm Henry Chopp, your host. Let's turn off this old tube radio. That's our time machine. Good night. God bless.
This changing world, this changing scene, where is it taking us? What does it mean? As long as we're certain of each other, we know we don't have to be afraid. These changing times, we rise above. We have no time for them. We have our love, and love is the only thing that still remains the same through all this change.